getting troops and equipment through the air and quickly on the ground and into combat. This was a challenge tackled in World War II with the use of gliders like the Waco. However, gliders were built to be expendable and could not be returned. They also had to rely on another powered aircraft for towing. A major problem for glider pilots was that they only had one chance at landing. This meant that they could not avoid obstacles unseen from the air, or even deliberate traps set by the enemy. Many glider troops never even got to battle. They simply perished in their vulnerable wooden hulls. Sometimes, the means of arrival was even more deadly than the enemy, and this was equally the same for both sides. Early in the war, the Germans produced the Gotha 242, a fairly successful glider that used a twin-boom tail arrangement. The 242 could carry a useful payload, which would be quickly unloaded through a large rear door. Some of the Gothas were fitted with small French piston engines, which negated the need for a tow plane. However, the most important feature of the powered glider was that its pilot could choose exactly the best place to land without running out of height. It also meant that after unloading, the aircraft could quickly take off and return to its base for another mission. This is the U.S. Air Force's Fairchild C-123 Provider. Much like the Gotha 242, it was originally built as an unpowered assault glider. Then later, engines were added. However, the glider version was nothing like the wooden Wacos and Gothas used in World War II. This aircraft was big and made entirely out of metal, and was also heavily reinforced for crash landings. If American soldiers had to glide to war again, then their safety was going to be a major consideration. Only two of the giant glider versions were built prior to the whole unpowered flight program being abandoned. However, the motorized version did go into production, and over 300 were successfully deployed. The Provider was very robust and able to cope with short and primitive landing areas. However, it wasn't considered quite as expendable as a Waco, which could fly right into a battle scenario. Shortly after war's end, American designers and military experts discussed the lessons learned from the conflict, speculating that it might be possible to land equipment without an aircraft actually landing, or at least not stopping. This idea, and other novel concepts of aerial support for ground soldiers, soon earned strong encouragement from a very qualified source, in the form of General Jim Gavitt, often called the Jumping General due to his insistence on parachuting with his men in the 82nd Airborne. Gavin was a larger-than-life general who understood the needs of airborne support, and later from a post in the Pentagon, championed the cause of the pod. However, the question still remained, would it even be possible for a powered aircraft to simply discharge its cargo on flyby? The material division at Wright-Patterson were given the task of finding some kind of device which could egress from a moving aircraft at a very low level. The concept of a pod began to evolve, totally self-contained and of sturdy construction. Test pods were built and vigorously tested. The main test involved pods being dropped from under the wings of a B-26 bomber, serving as a mother plane for the experiment. At first, the pods were released while the B-26 was still on the ground, taxiing at about 100 miles an hour. The results were mixed, but showed potential. However, when the pods were dropped from a mother plane in low-level flight, and out of range of propeller wash, the separation worked quite well. If these experiments could be translated into full-scale practice, then the opportunities could be limitless. The next problem was to find a suitable carrier aircraft. And here the Air Force looked to a Fairchild Provider stablemate, the C-119 Boxcar. The Boxcar had evolved from the Packet. Both aircraft employed the same twin boomtail configuration once used on the earlier German Gotha gliders. These were purpose-built heavy transport aircraft with powerful engines. A single C-119 was totally reconfigured at Fairchild's Hagersfield plant to convey a parasite pod from one destination to another. Evolving into the XC-120 Packplane, the lower half of the boxcar was completely removed, and the landing gear converted from the traditional tricycle arrangement into a quad configuration, leaving a suitable clear space to accommodate the pod. To lift the enormous loads into the air, the Packplane was equipped with two Wasp 4360 engines, which were actually more powerful than those used on the B-29. The engines provided enough power to carry Fairchild's Giant at 250 miles an hour, fully loaded. The Packplane itself had a crew of five, two pilots, an engineer, and two especially trained loadmasters. The crew would operate a totally self-contained power hoist to upload or download the pods, and each pod had its own set of wheels to facilitate towing. Connecting the plane to the pod was achieved via four special clasps located on the top of each pod. Although just as important, surrounding the outer edge of the pod was an inflatable seal, driven by compressed air. This was to ensure the airflow of the speeding plane did not separate its cargo. Each pod had a drive-through layout, allowing for loading at both ends, for cargo to be driven on at one side and off at the other. Either way, it was a capacious unit, able to support 20,000 pounds of freight, or over 60 well-equipped troops. Alternately, the pod could be configured as an ambulance, or a massive fuel tank. There were also plans for totally self-contained suites, as workshops, headquarters, or even hospitals, all able to be delivered as complete standalone units. The Packplane, with its rapid collection and drop-off capability, provided awesome displays to the military and public alike, and possibly seemed to have had serious appeal as an acquisition to the military. And to some extent it may have, although not sufficient to gain a production contract. Only one of this remarkable aircraft was ever built, and then a few years later, it was scrapped. However, if General Gabin's pod concept didn't live up entirely to his expectations, then certainly his prediction for the need of a frontline support transport with very rapid offloading did. The conflict in Vietnam provided many such uses for Lockheed's remarkable C-130, and nowhere more so than in the battle for Khe Sanh. In 1968, the North Vietnamese laid siege to an American Marine base. The objective was on a plateau in the Khe Sanh Valley in South Vietnam. Over time, the NVA surrounded the base, cutting off all land communications. Coinciding with the North's Tet Offensive on Saigon, holding the Khe Sanh base became a critical political as well as military U.S. objective. The siege lasted for almost 3 months, and for much of that time, the only way in or out was by airlift, and this was mostly achieved under heavy enemy fire. The assault transport's time had really come. Only aircraft like the C-130 and the C-123 could survive the relentless touch-and-go tactics demanded by the situation in Khe Sanh, which required rear-door delivery, sometimes speeding on the runway, and sometimes over it. The determined use of American assault transport under persistent enemy fire held the line. High-speed ejection of cargo, fast turnaround, and low-level parachute drops all played their role. The U.S. had exactly the right types of aircraft at the right time. Versatile, rugged, and purpose-built for need. Things may have been very different on that plateau in Southeast Asia, without the need having been defined by the experience of men like General Gavin. In truth, the Packplane would probably never have worked well in a frontline combat situation. The demands of sophisticated and careful handling on a quiet tarmac in Hagersfield, Maryland, is very different from the mayhem of a furious battle for a Marine base in the Khe Sanh Valley. But was the pod concept really so far off? Amongst General James Gavin's other predictions was the increased need to use helicopters in modern warfare. This is the Sikorsky S-64. The civilian version is known as the Sky Crane. The S-64 was extremely successful during recovery work and reconstruction in Vietnam. However, they also had another application of delivering purpose-built modules designed for specific functions, such as field headquarters, workshops, and hospitals. Some even called them pods.
If you enjoyed this video, please remember to like and subscribe. And as always, thank you for watching.